everyone, and welcome to Kingstown Communion for our Gifts of the Magi meal packing event. So glad to see all of you, a lot of familiar faces and new ones alike. If you haven't gotten a bulletin from your seat, look around and find one. We're going to do a short worship service before we begin, so you can follow along there and on the screen. We'll have the lyrics, so we're going to start off with a song. Should be familiar to many of you. Again, so glad you're here.
Frame it in light of the Christian story rather than framing it in light of Saint Nick. And so we thought, you know, hey, The Magi brought gifts to Jesus at a manger, and what if this could be our gift to Jesus this year? And so, thank you for coming today and being a part of this. Maybe because there's not Santa, it's not as glamorous. But what we're doing here is maybe not glamorous work. It's in fact really good and diligent work. It's the kind of work that Jesus would say is important. It's the kind of work that we're going to talk about in our Advent reading today, the kind of work that brings good news to the poor, right? And so we're really glad you're here. Would you stand with me and join us in what we call here at Kingstown a call to worship? There's some words on this piece of paper here, and the bolded parts are for you to respond. And so maybe find one of these around you. If you have not had one yet, you can share one with your family. Today is the second Sunday of Advent, actually, and as we move through Advent, this is a season of preparation for Jesus to arrive. The first Sunday is the Sunday of hope. The second Sunday is a Sunday of love, which I think makes a lot of sense for what we're doing here today, a Sunday of love. The next Sunday is a Sunday of joy, and the fourth Sunday is a Sunday of peace. And so would you join me in this call to worship? God, our redeeming love, be to us as a bulldozer of your Spirit. Clear your road in us. Clear a path through the litter of possessions and obsessions. Thrust aside our divided aims and devious games. Topple the ramparts of pride and the doubts that deride. Make a highway on which Christ may come. Take possession of the whole territory of our being, that we may only know who we are in light of Jesus. So would you stay standing to sing this congregational song all together, one you will know with a few words you may not know?
Yeah, so this is a familiar carol that that sung around this time of year, but it's also a mashup with one of the songs that we sing a lot here at our church. So I just wanted to teach you the chorus of that other song, so when you hear it, you can sing along, sing out, sounds great. So it just goes like this.
King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, rise up. Who can stand against us? You are strong to save in your mighty name. King of heaven, come.
Let's try it again.
Heaven come.
not familiar to you, in our church, I say the words, the Lord be with you, and you will respond, and also with you. And so the Lord be with you. Let us pray. God, we are here today because we know you are coming, and we want to be ready for your coming. We want our hearts to be ready. We want our actions to be ready. We want the things we care about to be the things you care about. We want the way that we live our lives, what we put our hands to, what we put our money to be the things that you would have us care about. And so we give this over to you, Jesus, as a gift this Christmas from us, people who are coming to grips with who we are and who you've called us to be, and are surrendering our hearts and our actions to that. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And as you're seated, I'd love to invite forward Carly and Megan. This family is going to light for us our Advent candle. We have an Advent wreath up here, and we are on the second Sunday of Advent, as I said. You can follow along here. There's a response for you as well. You can take the microphone right there. Perfect. Don't need to do anything to it. He'll turn it on.
Isaiah 61:1-3, 8-9.
The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of retribution of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, planted to display the Lord's glory. For I, the Lord, love justice and hate wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their reparation, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed.
We light this candle as a symbol of Christ, our redeeming love, the one whose grace and mercy never fails, the one who saves us.
O come, let us adore him, Christ, our redeeming love.
There's a list of things. First of all, we have a youth group, And we already have about 11 kids coming tonight over to the Binsky's house. They didn't know about, you know, about a week ago. We told them they were coming to their house after some things changed. But we're coming to the Binsky's home tonight. We are actually going to meet there, drive to Walmart together, go shopping with all of our youth for some families who are in need of some Christmas presents and some actual things to wear, or some coats and socks and all of that. We're going to take them shopping, send them on a scavenger hunt in Walmart to go pick out all of those things, come back, we're going to wrap them and have a Christmas party at the Binsky's home. We have a youth group that meets once a month because we believe that we are real busy people, and it's hard to do a youth group more than once a month. So if you're looking for something to engage in that would fit in your schedule, monthly is what we do, and we have a schedule that we can give you to let you know more about that. We're just beginning. Our youth don't know each other that well, so it's a perfect time to just join into something that's just getting off the ground. Then we have a caroling benefit happening. One of our partners in ministry in the area is the Lorton Community Action Center. And sometimes you can bring in goods like food, which that will be a part of it. Sometimes it's really good to give a nonprofit the gift of money, because they have operations costs and they have gifts that they'd like to give to people who maybe need their utilities paid and things like that. So we are going to raise money through a night of caroling at Zenberger, who's also one of our community partners now. I love it. I love business, church, and nonprofit all coming together to do something really good together. And so 7 p.m. this Tuesday at Zenberger, 20% of the sales will go to the Lorton Community Action Center. We also have our Knowles tree lighting. I'm going to walk around and make you a little awkward this morning while you're serving. I'm going to be asking you, hey, would you like to be a greeter at our Knowles tree lighting? This happens every year, but we need people to actually host it and to be present, to be really welcoming, and a good place to direct people to go to Santa, direct people. It's a wonderful experience. And so please help us volunteer to be a part of that. Again, this is December 14th. And then we as a church, we don't do your typical Christmas Eve service. In fact, we do it one night before. So on the 23rd, we will be outside at Knoll's Produce. We'll have heaters, but you bundle up, you get close to your loved ones, and we sing carols, and we have live animals, and it looks like the manger, and it feels like you're at the base of the manger. And so if you would like to be a part of that, that's 5:30 and 7 p.m. on the 23rd. Keep this with you, and maybe refer to it, put it on your refrigerator, and stay with us through this season of Advent into Christmas. With all that, I'd love to invite forward Matt to read our scripture today.
From John. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." And they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah had said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. We are currently working our way through a sermon series. I said last week that every year in the church, this time of year, you read the same scriptures over and over again. You know the story. You've heard the story. You hear it over and over and over again. And so the job of the preacher is to try to tell you this story in a new way every year, to try to bring life to it, a story that you might know so well. It's one of the hardest seasons of the church to preach because you know the story. So how do we bring this alive for you again? So this Christmas, we are working our way through a sermon series on the names of Jesus. And today we are going to talk about what it means that Jesus is the great Redeemer. And so I wonder what you feel like. Here's a question for you. I wonder what you feel like when a picture is taken of you, when you see a picture of yourself. Are you one of those people who always think they look horrible in photographs? Or do you think generally that you're super photogenic? It's okay to admit that. I think I'm generally photogenic. So I have a number of people in my life who claim they always look horrible in photographs. Now think for a second about that logic. Think for a second about that logic of such a conviction. You see yourself in a photograph and you think that person does not look as beautiful and charming and witty and relaxed and cool as I like to think I look. Either that phone has a bad camera, or the photographer is hopeless at it. He isn't holding the phone high enough to get your right angle, or I have a gene that makes me drop all my fine qualities the moment someone points a camera lens at me. Or this is the most likely. I have the kind of warm and effusive personality that's just impossible to capture in a single two-dimensional photo, right? Yes. We could simply say that's what the photograph shows. So I guess that's what I must look like then. And maybe I should just deal with that reality. But we don't do that. Instead, we redeem that reality in ourselves, right? We don't say, that's what I look like. Oh my gosh, we don't take that reality into heart, but we redeem it. We save ourselves from the possibility of that we possibly could look that bad by saying, I always look terrible in photographs, so it's just the photographs. In other words, I know who I am. I know who I am. No one else really knows who I am, least of all that cruel and distorting and cold-hearted phone that takes those horrific photos of me. I know who I am. Do you? Okay, fair enough. You know, you're more wonderful and more exquisite in looks and intelligence and character and taste and talent and style than anyone could describe or capture about you. But do you really know who you are? One of the benefits of social media is that it gives us innumerable opportunities to redeem ourselves. Innumerable opportunities to present ourselves to one another at our best, right? Isn't that what Facebook and Instagram is for? A chance to say, hey y'all, out there, I'm in the middle of a wild party right now, but I love you, and here's a few photos of me that don't do me justice, of course, but at least remind you that I'm lots of fun. We're constantly making it easy for people to understand how brilliant, but unthreatening we are. One thing people have started putting on resumes even is a little line under their full name that says goal. And what follows is a succinct but generic summary of everything they have to bring to the world. Something like, high achiever, who selflessly wants to use my outstanding gifts with inevitably less wise and gifted people, and to apply my mastery of all technology, including that not yet invented, to bring about lasting change in the world. When we're immersed in such a culture of like digitally enhanced appearances and fleeting connections, it's very hard to answer the question, really answer the question, who are you? Instead, we're constantly answering the question, who can I persuade people that I am, right? What we call successful people are those who've convinced a large number of the public that they're brilliant, but unthreatening. And that's why successful people often find this question, who am I, particularly hard to answer, because they've peddled their publicity so many times they've started to believe it themselves. Success is a drug that makes you think your identity and your character are products you can market to customers. You think you're fooling them, but in the end, the one you're really fooling is yourself. By contrast, when you've had months or years out of work, when you've had the courage to admit the one thing in life you truly want and yet it's never happened for you, when you've experienced a terrible illness or injury that's left you in need of long-term care, or when you or your family have had to bear a private burden together. If exposed would bring down a cloud of public shame, maybe. If this is your story, then the likelihood is you do know who you are. Even if who you are is a daily struggle, because you know what it's like to need to be saved. You know what it's like to be searching for real redemption rather than blaming the camera. John's gospel begins with a great sweeping prologue, locating Jesus at the heart of God's purposes and at the heart of the universe. And then we find ourselves abruptly face to face with a man giving testimony, a man called John, a man who sets up stall some way from the epicenter of Israel, some way from Jerusalem, from the temple, from the people who decided what was godly, indeed on the other side of the Jordan, outside the traditional boundaries of the promised land. And John doesn't have a website or an Instagram account. There is no way for John to peddle the version of himself he'd like to believe he was or would like people to see about him. It's truly hard to know who John is and what he stands for. The high and mighties send their lackeys to say to John, "Who are you?" And he has an answer for them. It's a very strange answer. He says, "I am not." "I am not," is what John says. It's a funny kind of answer. He repeats it several times. There's something almost aggressive about it. But that quickly makes sense when you realize that the people John's talking to are messengers from the very same crowd of leaders who'll put both John and Jesus to death 2 or 3 years after this conversation. This isn't an idle game of 20 questions where only John knows the answer and everyone else has to guess, and he takes delight in, you know, just shaking his head. "Who are you?" "I'm not." No, this is this like cross-examination with John's head on the block. His life depends on this answer, answering this question. Eventually, John puts his interrogators out of their misery and gives them a straight answer. "I am the voice of the one crying out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord." These words are actually a quotation from the prophet Isaiah, and they're this clear statement from John that he's well in line with the way that God has worked over centuries and prepared Israel for this moment. But they also say a lot about John. They say what he is, a voice, where he is in the wilderness, what he's doing, crying out, and what is really going on, the fact that the Lord is coming soon. John is asked the question over and over again, "Who are you?" And his answer is, "I can't answer that. I can't answer that question except in relation to Jesus." Think about those words for a moment. "I can't answer that question except in relation to Jesus." Is that your answer? Rather than saying, "I know who I am," you've just got the focus wrong, or the camera wrong, or the photographer wrong, or the angle wrong. Rather than saving ourselves from who we are by redeeming the story about ourselves, John says, "I don't even know who I am." John says, I only know who I am except in relation to Jesus. I don't know who I am except that I know I cannot save myself. I cannot redeem my own story. I don't know who I am outside of God's, not mine. Not my redeeming work, but God's redeeming work. I don't know who I am outside the fact that I am just a voice. And I'm just one crying in the wilderness, one who is just making a way for Jesus because Jesus made a way for me first. I'm just sharing the good news as the great redeemer because that great redeemer redeemed me, saved me. I don't have any purpose in life, any goal in life, any satisfaction in life, any bearings in life, any wisdom in life, any security in life, any identity in life, aside from Jesus. Jesus is the way I know who I am. And for many of us, Jesus feels more like it's just a choice.
like a figure with whom we choose to identify our faith and something we could theoretically use to redeem ourselves or save ourselves if and when we need it. But to claim Jesus as our great redeemer is to say that we don't know who we are, except for the one who redeemed us. Would you pray with me? God, great redeemer, each of our stories has nuances of how you have saved us like John, how we are no one. I am not, we are not, without how you have done a work of beauty in our lives. How you have saved us from ourselves, saved us from the world's evil, redeemed the worst part of ourselves, redeemed the worst things we could have done, redeemed even the evil of this world, making something beautiful out of something horrible. That's the work you do. And we are no one outside of that. And that's why, God, we come to this table today. And we break bread with you. And you remind us at this meal that it's the meal that gathers us and reminds us that you are doing a redeeming work in us. You are making beauty out of our ashes. We share cup with you, Jesus, at this table, being reminded that all are invited here, and that through this cup, we receive salvation. And are reminded that we cannot save ourselves. Who are we, God, except for redeemed by you? And so pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice today. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world this living witness of your redemption. All honor and glory is yours, now and forever, God. Amen. Amen. For those who are assisting, come forward. Come on down. We're going to use all of you. The band receives, we want you to know, wherever you come from, whatever your tradition is, whatever your background is, the thing that makes the Methodist way of viewing, we're Wesleyan, we're Methodist, we view the table, what makes it so beautiful is that this is truly an open table. You can come from whatever your tradition of faith is, you may come to this table, it's open for you, no matter where you are, even if today you're like, I'm not quite sure whether I'm buying into this service, but I'm here to serve, and that's where I'm here, that's fine. Wherever you are today, it's grace that brought you here to serve, and so even if that's where you are welcome to this table. Everyone is welcome here. Please choose to come today. If that's something that's stirring inside of you, come. Would you all maybe stand in the middle? There you go. And we have gluten-free elements if you need, and those of you who go to our church and you have a gift of offering to give today, could you drop it in the basket as you come forward? Come and taste and see that God is good.
4 days behind me on it, and it's thundering with her long
Welcome her, she was so